on the desk.
Thank you, TJ and friends. My name is Soddle, and it's a huge honor for me to be joined by Savitz on the decks to bring you this tournament full of incredibly high-level players, the very best that Europe has to offer. Savitz, I'm sure you feel the same way.
Oh, yeah, this is the big one for me. Maybe the most interesting tournament so far this year. Eight players who all work very hard throughout the year. They deserve to be here. No weak players at all here.
So as you can see, our first game is going to be RDU versus Stan Adachi, and we just got a look at the bans here. And it looks like RDU's Hunter has been banned out, while Stan has lost his Shaman. How do you feel about this?
Really interesting. I wasn't really thinking about the Hunter as something that has to be banned ever since the Call of the Wild got nerfed to 9 mana as well. So it's a little bit weaker in that sense. But Hunter was something that Stan Adachi just didn't want to play against. So I guess it makes more sense with his lineup.
Would you agree that overall RDU feels like he has a lineup advantage in this matchup? It feels like there's a lot of decks, you know, potentially the Zoo, potentially the Rogue and the Hunter as well, that can really beat up some of these control decks that Stan has brought with him.
Yeah, potentially he could have a small edge. Stan Adachi playing the only Anything Paladin of this tournament, and we're gonna see him play it in the very first game of the tournament as well.
Yep, straight into the action, and is going to be that unique Anything Paladin for Stan Adachi. RDU queuing up his Rogue, and Stan Adachi choosing to hold on to the Equality there, as well as the Outdoor Peacekeeper. Yep. RDU going for a much more aggressive Mulligan. Did not have a pretty looking Rogue hand, but
now it's much better.
Yeah, now it's looking pretty rosy. That is a solid curve starting off.
It really is. That hand wouldn't be the best possible against the aggressive strategy, but Stan Adachi with his Anything Paladin is not going to be putting much pressure early on, so Tomb Pillager, Azure Drake, Auctioneer. Those might even be the best three cards possible for the opening hand. Leeroy, well, a little bit early for that, but I'm sure RDU is still happy with what he's got.
Yeah, so there are a bunch of different Rogue builds available, and even within the Miracle archetype, RDU, I believe, is running the Questing Adventurer variant, which is such a weird throwback. It was like one of the original forms of Miracle Rogue that came out, the Questing Adventurers buffing them up to huge sizes with the preps and backstabs and coins, but suddenly it's come back with a vengeance, and most people are agreeing that this is one of the most powerful builds of Rogue, especially for tournament formats.
Yeah, it's really interesting, because when I first heard about the Questing Adventurers making an impact in the Rogue decks, I thought, yeah, maybe it's because of Barnes. Like, that's such a powerful combination, like, if you get the Questing from the Barnes. But RDU is not even running a Barnes, so Questing Adventurer for Rogue might have been just kind of a sleeper, and in a sense that people didn't realize its strength early on.
Yep, so RDU here had the option to make one of those kind of ambitious Rogue curves where he could have coined out Tomb Pillager and then tried to coin out the Drake next turn, but problem with that being, if he has the true Silver Champion to Stan Adachi, then suddenly that's a lot of value being given over two turns to the true Silver. So he's just going to hold on to his coin here long term.
Yep. I really like holding on to the coin. If he was to coin out the Doom Military, there was no good follow-up. Shadow Strike potentially would have been okay, but not necessarily. And Stan Adachi's Barnes this time around is not going to get him anything great. That Harrison Jones, just the 1-1, not being able to get any extra benefits out of it.
Yeah, Barnes is such a high percentage card in Anything Paladin, definitely one of the stronger decks, because you know, not only can you hit your Ragnaros Lightlords and Fire Lord as well if you're running it, as well as Tyrion, but just pulling an extra Murloc is so huge for the deck if you pull out a Bluegill or a Warleader.
Yeah, because quite often, once you get to 10 mana, there hasn't been that many Murlocs dead. Right. You might have potentially maybe not even drawn a single Warleader, for example, so Barnes helps with getting those Murlocs on the board early on. But didn't work. It doesn't always work. It is an unreliable card. Here, RDU, 5 mana. Unfortunately for him, he can't really access the coin from the Tomb Pillager, so the Auctioneer turn is probably something that he's not going to do just yet. Would love to have that extra coin.
Yeah, it's one of the things that you'll often see people do against Rogue is try and neutralize the Tomb Pillager in ways that aren't killing it. You know, you'll see, like, in the Rogue Mirror, it's pretty much the best sap target, for example, to send it back, or just, you know, hexing it, polymorphing it, you know, neutralizing it with the Outdoor Peacekeeper. Just anything that can stall them getting those extra coins in their hand, because when you're playing Questing Adventurer, Edwin Van Cleef, and Auctioneer in your deck, that is a lot of uses that you have for coins in your hand.
Yeah, it's certainly Stan Adachi's hand not looking so great. 6 mana and just going to Hero Power Pass. Does have that blue kill, but no Warleader. It wouldn't really do much to play it there. In combination with the Warleader, he could have the 4 damage charge. So that's something that he is probably looking to potentially get from the top of his deck. that equality that he kept in the starting hand is kind of an insurance, though, in combination with the Wild Pyromancer, so he will be able to clear any board that that RDU creates.
Yep, speaking of clears, though, this is a pretty reasonable one to take care of the Drake. The Consecration and Bluegill Warrior gets rid of it, and again, that Tomb Pillager is just stuck around, not giving over that bounty to RDU with the coin. But that Edwin in hand now is a very big deal. He has questing as well, so he can choose to push all in very soon, or he can try and break up his threats one by one and try and pull out on a quality on his first threat and then follow up with the second one afterwards. Like, how do you see this game moving forward from here, Savitz?
I would go for maybe something like Questing Adventure, Cold Blood. Maybe one prep into a fan. The Auctioneer would be a little bit like too much draw. He doesn't have the Conceal just yet. Going for the Questing and the Edwin, I think, is a little bit too many eggs in one basket. He's just gonna go for the Auctioneer here, and probably like coin out and hope for a Conceal. One of those prep fans can be cycled, I believe, but if he goes for the second one, that should result in overdraw, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, that looks about right to me. Prep fan is gonna be used. Still has that one mana remaining that he's left open for a Conceal if he gets it. Doesn't hit it though, but yeah, I like this line a lot too, because yep. Your opponent has shown you over the last couple of turns that True Silver Champion is not in their range. You've had Drakes and Tomb Pillagers on the board that just haven't been hit by the weapon. So if there were to be an equality in the hand, you would probably get it used on this board, and then your huge aggressive threats can follow up. But that True Silver now potentially gets Shtarn out of a bit of a mess in this situation.
Yeah, that True Silver is so good. Because if he went for the Wild Pyro equality here, it would be too early. Like, we know it would be too early for it. Like, it would be way too early for it. But Tanudashi would have had to do it. That Auctioneer is something he can't really leave on the board. And True Silver, Consecration. Let's him clear the board. And RDU with how many cards? I think he's going to overdraw one here.
Certainly is. That addition of the extra coin gets RDU into trouble, but I think his line on the previous turn is understandable. You know, any one mana card that he drew, the Conceal was such a big hit with what he did, and you know, Stan had shown that he wants to leave that Tomb Pillager up, so no great expectation for RDU to draw the coin there.
We certainly can't blame him for going that play right there. Even though I personally would have maybe leaned towards a Questing Adventure, but here 10 cards available to him, so many things to do. Looks like he's maybe going for we know that he's going for the second Auctioneer, but the Edwin, he gets a Conceal, so he could play the Edwin Van Cleef and Conceal it, but that equality, RDU knows that the Standard Dash is playing two of those, so.
And that's the thing, from RDU's perspective, do you feel like you've checked for equality at this point in the game? I'm not sure you do, right?
Because no,
the True Silver draw from Shtarn just changed everything. That really prevented RDU from getting any kind of read on the AoE in his hand.
I agree. And he is going to go for the Concealed Questing Adventure instead of the Van Cleef here. Such a weird situation, because RDU, I feel like, is outvaluing Shtarn Odashi by quite a bit, but he's also down to 9 health after this True Silver attack, and there is that, I believe, there's one blue kill only dead, so anything happening wouldn't do much.
10 mana, 2 damage doesn't seem too appealing at this point.
But Sanudashi does have lethal setup over 2 turns because of that True Silver, because he will be able to attack next turn with the True Silver Champion, then attack with it again on the following turn and use the anything that happens. So if RDU wants to take this one, he needs to be fast.
Right, the danger with Rogue, if you intend to make that kind of play, is that, you know, can you afford 2 turns of just hitting face when you're staring down a board like this? And RDU is recognizing the situation perfectly and saying, okay, I need to stop Shtarn from racing me here. I need to try and make a counter push. Is the Ragnaros Light Lord healing him back up to 30? Is that going to be enough to give him the confidence to go here?
Well, I don't think he has any other option. There's no way for him to clear. He has to go for the face and just maybe play the Rack and the Doomsayer. Doesn't really matter if you play the Doomsayer, but CPOs might as well. Standard Yashi knows that he might still die, but I don't know. I guess that you could justify in some ways to, like, kill the Tomb Blitzer, but I would hate to see the Tomb Blitzer attack, because, like, how do you win then if you don't set up the lethal here?
Yeah, I totally agree, but I was just wondering here whether the Doomsayer is to his benefit or not. I guess it is slightly. It's just, you know, if you're not going to die here to RDU, then by not playing the Doomsayer, you're also insisting that they clear your AA or else you're going to be through persistent healing. But yeah, Doomsayer is such a clean setup here. And with 11, 12, 15 damage on board, plus the Leroy, 21, SI7 agent is 23. He's short, so unless some Blood Mage miracles happen here.
There is a way out with the, potentially with the Journey below as well, because he could discover a taunt minion.
That's
from
true.
Such an abomination or infested tauren. Those would keep him safe in case that he does not get the lethal.
Yep, I think Chillmore as well. I think those are the only three that you can pick up that have Death Rattle in the game now after our long-departed friend Sludge Belcher has disappeared from the game.
Yeah. Oh, looks like he's going to go for a Drake instead. Trying to think if there's any way he can find a way. No, I just don't see it. I don't think there's a... and he's not even going for the journey below. So he's going to try to clear and just hope that Sanity does not have one damage.
I don't know. I don't know.
It's just...
It seems sketchy. It's hard from our position, of course.
It
we
is.
Have cast division. We know it's going to happen. But how often do you see a control paladin make that aggressive play? Over three turns, he's been going face to set this up.
Pretty much never. So
I think you have to have the read that this one Bluegill Warrior is going to end your life. Yeah. I said 10 mana, 2 damage isn't too appealing, but when it ends the game, that'll do the job as well as anything else.
10 mana Bluegill. For lethal, that is amazing.
Yeah, it's the hidden nerf. You didn't see that in the patch notes, but Bluegill Warrior actually costs 10 mana now. It's one of the things that was adjusted.
Quite a nerf, I would say.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, we have the caster vision, but I do still feel like it looked like a situation after the True Silver attack. It was fairly obvious that Standard Dash does have the follow-up damage to finish off the game. So I do think that the RDU should have went for the journey below to try find that taunt, although there might just be those two, like Abomination and the Infested Door, and I'm not sure if there's anything else.
There's a Chillmore as well.
Chillmore, Chillmore.
We will see if RDU can recover from this slight deficit right after this, so don't go anywhere, guys. Welcome back, guys, to the Europe Last Call Invitational. We are in our first quarterfinal game between RDU and Stan Adachi. Stan took down the first game with his Anyfin Paladin with that devastating 10-mana Bluegill Warrior, so... RDU is going to have to find a way to fight back into this series. But as I said at the start, I still feel like overall he has a lot of good matchups available to him with some of his, you know, control busting kind of aggressive decks. But I think actually that Hunter ban could end up being pretty smart for Stan Adachi, because mid-range Hunter, classically one of the worst matchups for anything Paladin, one of the worst matchups for Reno Lock as well.
Yeah.
So it could be a big deal.
I have to agree. Like, if Call of the Wild was still 8 mana, then I would have been like, yeah, well, I mean, that makes a lot of sense.
Right.
And that's definitely the right thing to do. But just like, it feels considerably worse to me. But still, that Hunter deck, pretty powerful with the kill commands and all that. The Reno Warlock that Standard Ash is running especially would struggle a lot, as well as the Rogue. Rogue also has a bad matchup against the Hunter, regardless of the mana cost of Call of the Wild. By the way, I have to say that I'm a huge fan of Stan Rudash's Malugus Rogue play. He actually kind of, for me, that's kind of the deck that I know him for the most.
Interesting.
He reached rank 1 legend with this Malugus list when it was not really a thing. And nobody else was playing it. It was unheard of around 2 months ago for somebody to be playing a Malugus Rogue yet, and do so well as he has done.
Yeah, and he has pretty much the dream opening when you're going second here against Zu. After RDU led with the Flame Imp, he had the backstab. Now, pretty much any 2-mana minion that gets played is going to just die to coin SI7 agent here. So this draw from Stan Adachi puts him on Dream Street against the Zu here. But if anyone is equipped to fight their way out of this situation, it is RDU, because I know he considers, and with good reason based on evidence, that he is perhaps the strongest Zu player in the world.
Yep, and Zu Warlock, I was talking with Firebat a little bit earlier today, and Firebat was saying that this Zu Warlock might be the weak spot in RDU's lineup, and it might not be that well positioned in the meta right now. Stunner Darcy with such an amazing starting hand here, though. RDU's hand is not bad either, like having an Imp Gang boss on turn 3, having another one in his hand. Maybe if he finds Soulfire to go with it, could get something done.
Yeah, we've seen this situation time and time again in these HCT events where players have brought decks that they are very loyal to. We've seen Freeze Mage loyalists, Rogue loyalists, in this case, a Zoo loyalist in RDU, and you know they will point to their win rate statistics on their tracking programs and say, hey, this deck's insane for me, but playing a high-level tournament against high-level opposition is a very different story to playing on ladder. And there's a reason why you know you're the only person that's bringing one of these decks quite often. And we'll see if RDU's decision to bring Zoo here is going to come back to bite him. But in this situation right here, it's not looking too pretty. But there are a lot of decks that would struggle to beat this curve from a Rogue.
Yeah, they're really... Oh, that's Rogue. The Rogue draw is like so brutal. It's just that... Turn 2 comboed Assai, turn 3 comboed Assai. So hard to fight from behind in a situation like this. Are you picking up another Direwolf Alpha? That's not too helpful. With this 5 mana, all those 2 drops, it's not very smooth on the mana. Those don't really help him fight back.
Yeah, it's not looking promising, but if RDU can make a push here, perhaps you know, take out one of the 3/3s with one of the Direwolves, get perhaps a Lucky Knife on the Azure Drake and start to, you know, create more tension on the board. Shtan has now run dry in his hand. There is not a lot happening unless he draws some useful stuff over the next couple of turns here. So this turn feels like a window for RDU that will be difficult for him to identify. You know, his only clue really is the hand size of Shtanadachi, hoping that he can try and outvalue him if he can tidy up this board, but he needs to find a way to make a push back in the other direction right now.
Yeah, I'm trying to see if there was a way to play the maybe the Dark Shadow Librarian with the juggler and just hope to cycle into a Soul Fire to fight back, but I'm not sure if he's that desperate. Because with... No. I mean, kind of trying to like just dig deeper in his deck, but that still takes that one.
There it is.
Oh, he gets
there
the
juggle
he wanted. Yeah. So let's see what the other one goes. That's not bad either.
Yeah, I mean, as long as they kept hitting minions and one of them took out the Drake, that is a pretty strong outcome for RDU here. So as there's definitely two priority targets on the board now that have to go down. But Shtan, draws, as I said, draws. Needed to draw some gas, and Drake picking up a Tomb Pillager. I'm pretty sure that qualifies.
I don't know if that could have been any better. At 5 mana, no play available. Oh, Azure Drake. Oh. Let's do it. Azure Drake on curve. Not only that, but he also draws into the Tomb Pillager. So... from here on out, it's going to be very hard. But RDU becoming a Silverware Golem, and there's a nice synergy there with that Darkshire Librarian. He's also able to empty his hand first with that Direwolf Alpha to make sure that the Silverware Golem gets on the board for free.
Yeah, and Silverware Golem itself actually adds a new kind of dimension of positioning with Zoo, because Silverware Golem, of course, is always summoned on the far right-hand side of the board, which I think is what RDU was thinking about there for the first 20 seconds or so of this turn, because there was definitely no consideration of any other turn. This turn essentially played itself in terms of which cards you were playing, but he wanted to make sure that his positioning with the Direwolf Alpha after the Golem spawn was just absolutely perfect.
Yeah, nothing really... Else to consider there, like you said. Here, Shtanadachi, he has his opponent down to fairly low, but that Direwolf Alpha is just such a high priority target to clear. RDU with a Dark Peddler, if this gives him a Soulfire, it would be so good.
Yeah, Soulfire is absolutely huge here, but just already having that Abusive Sergeant, and you know, to no surprise to me, Abusive Sergeant is still essentially core in Zoo decks, despite being a 1-1. It's such a powerful effect. You know, at 2-1, I would argue that it was perhaps the best card in the deck.
Yeah.
And now, even at 1-1, it's still incredibly powerful. So
definitely very strong. I like the Mortal Coil pickup here. Being able to now finish off that Tomb Pillager very easily. Another Abusive. Oh, that makes it kind of tempting to just go face, because you're going to miss out on 7. Oh, Soulfire. All right, I guess 7 to face and Soulfire to Drake.
7 to face is looking good to me. But now with that additional coin, if Shtan can pick up just one extra burst spell here, he actually has a reasonably quick clock of his own. So this might come down to a straight-up old-fashioned race situation here. We'll see what Shtan can pick up over the next couple of turns. Shiv is fine. I think you have to cycle it now, though, right? As opposed to holding on...
I think so too. Like, there's so many. Like, you still have 5 mana available, so almost anything that you find from the Shiv card draw, you will still be able to play. Well, it's like one of the worst things, but I would imagine that he's still going to cast it here, because it is 3 mana to play that
Silverware back. It's a reasonable turn to draw it. It's usually not a very strong card against Zoo, but Silverware Golem is honestly one of the best cards to sap, because it's a very bad card to spend 3 mana on. If you sap a Councilman or an Imp Gang boss, for example, they're happy to spend 3 mana on playing that again!
Well, not spending 3 mana there.
Wow!
Or do you get the Doom card. Not too lucky though, because he is fairly deep into his deck at this point, so it was about time to start drawing those, but still very good draw. Gets a silver back to the back on the board, and Stanudashi, Zap, it did still kind of heal him for 3, so it wasn't completely worthless, although not as good as he would have hoped so.
This could all hinge on this draw here. Stan needs one extra piece of help. That is lethal next turn. Malagos, Coin, Sinister Strike, Prepovis will end the game next turn. Does Stan hold on here? Is it his highest win rate play to say you do not have 4 damage? Because asking a Zoo to do 4 is not the hardest thing in the world.
Oh man, it's such a difficult situation. There is a chance that he would also pick up another damage card from the top of his deck to be able to end the game if he chose to eviscerate the 3-3 here. If he doesn't do the eviscerate on the Silver Golem, it's much more likely that he will die next time. Because there's one more Soulfire, one more Silver Golem. He's going to eviscerate. So he is not going to have the lethal setup anymore, unless RDU chooses to go face with everything.
So let's think about what was remaining in RDU's deck, because Stan knows the list exactly. He's seen one Soulfire gone, he's seen both Abusive Sergeants gone, he's seen one Doomguard gone. So Defender of Argus would need help. It would need a buff from another card. The only cards that kill you directly are Soulfire number 2 and Doomguard number 2.
Yeah, so both Direwolves were
Direwolves. That's are true played. As well, yeah.
Both Abusives were played. So I think it's pretty much just, realistically, it's pretty much just one Soulfire, one Doomguard.
Yeah, personally, I think I favor taking the risk there. I feel like, you know, your single Azuradrake on board and then looking at the rest of your hand, it didn't feel like you were going to be able to fight long-term on the board against Zoo, so.
Yeah. I'm trying to, refrain from trying to call that would have been the play, because we can see that if Stanudashi chose to held on to the eviscerate, he would have just won the game. So that decision to eviscerate the Silver Golem cost him the game, but it is not necessarily a mistake. It would have been possible that RDU top deck another Doomguard or Soulfire had one in his hand already. Well, probably not because of the way that the game played out, but in that case he would have been punished for it.
Yeah, it's a game of percentages, and it's about which line is going to win the game more often. So we will give you guys a moment to mull over the percentages, and we'll be right back after this. Welcome back, guys. We are just about ready to get into game 3 of this series, but we had a moment there to mull over some percentages while we were on that break. And, you know, thinking about it more, I think Standard actually had a very high percentage of good draws left in his deck as well, right?
So. Yeah, I mean, he's the rank 1 legend player with that deck. It's impossible for me to start criticizing his his plays too much. There were a lot of draws, and even though he by using the eviscerate, he lost that lethal setup. There were other cards such as Fan of Knives that he could have maybe top deck there and then go for the Malugus prep Fan of Knives, which potentially, while not killing his opponent, would put him in a position where he would be very likely to win the match or the game.
I still like holding it and going face. I'm just saying, I'm putting that out there, but Stanudashi probably does know better than me. He is a very good Malagos rogue player, as you said. But speaking of Malagos, we are going to see a heck of a lot more of that card coming up with the Druid Mirror coming up here. But Stanudashi is playing the modern tech, the this week's tech of the Jungle Moonkin Curator version of this deck.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of that version on the ladder recently, and it looks like Stanudashi has also picked up on it. I believe there's only one Jungle Moonkin in this
Correct.
Particular list. And about these decks, I wanted to point out that RDU is playing Malagos Druid, but he is not playing York Druid. There is no Yorksaron in RDU's Druid list, so that will not be happening. He has replaced it with Ragnaros the Fire Lord. Other than that, the list looks fairly standard, but RDU has made the call that, okay, Yorksaron is a little bit worse now after the changes that happened earlier this week. Stanudashi still sticking with it.
Yep. Shnaud actually sticking to the Yogg guns here. Yogg is still a part of this new list that a lot of people have been playing to High Legend recently with the addition of the Jungle Moonkin. And with the Curator in the deck, of course, you now have the Dragons in the form of Azir Drake and Malagos. And now you also have a Beast as well to give you that chance of drawing two with Curator. And anytime Curator draws two, it's an incredibly powerful card.
Yeah, it's a pretty cool deck, in my opinion, to be running the Curator. It fits very... very well in that. Also, having that extra taunt is very helpful in some matchups, buying more time to get to those even stronger turns. Also, with the help of gods like an Innervate, Nourish, and Wild Growth, you can get to them with the 4-6 taunt even faster than other decks could. And speaking of Curator, there it is.
There he is. And it looks like Shtanad actually is going to go for the Innervate Nourish here. And this is actually one of the trickier decisions that I've seen with a Nourish. But having now drawn the Curator, that has a really strong chance of drawing you two if you get to it within the next couple of turns. So I definitely don't mind the ramp Nourish here at all.
I think he should definitely get the mana here. With a hand like this, it's so important. And getting the mana is quite often kind of the play to win in the mirror matchup. I really don't like the Innervate into the draw this early on. Mm-hmm. On turn three, when you do it for mana, there's just like so many turns remaining where you get the benefit from it. Yes, there is that risk that you will end up drawing spell after spell and no card draw,
yep,
and then kind of getting exhausted on the resources. But that Curator is a solid kind of like a solid card to make sure that he won't be completely out of place.
Yeah, I mean, as a general rule with Nourish, you know, take a look at your hand and look at how much mana you can spend on just proactive, non-situational plays, right? And right now, Shtan has the Arcane Giant and the Curator available to him, so that's, you know, depending on the giant cost, you know, 13 to 14 mana he can spend over the next couple of turns, so ramping for the mana there definitely seems appropriate, but Living Roots off the top,
yeah,
not what he needed.
That's the downside of going for the mana. Even though he had the extra mana, he was not able to use it, and those three extra draws that he could have potentially gotten from the Nourish would have secured a strong play there in turn five.
There he is. There's the Jungle Moonkin. Cannot wait. This is a dangerous matchup to play Moonkin on the board, though. You better be damn sure you are getting enough of an advantage out of it for it to be worth it, because you can be pretty sure the other Druid can take advantage of it, too.
Yeah, it's like... you know that the other Druid is playing exactly the same stuff as you are when it comes to spells, so all the benefits that you get from it, your opponent will also be able to get. And things like just Rot for three and draw a card on the Moonkin. It's just the Moonkin won't get all that much value.
I mean, this is just the tech choice in the mirror, right? It's like, why would I play Moonkin? I'll just take advantage of my opponent's Moonkin. Like, that seems fine to me.
Yeah, I feel like the biggest upside of the Jungle Moonkin is not really in this matchup. It's more like against decks such as Zoo Warlock,
yep,
just getting that powerful swipe and all the benefits from those spells against decks that can't really benefit so much from it, but. Oof, that's a rough-looking Raven Owl right there. None of these cards look too good. I guess Innervate is fine. Power of the Wild, does have a Living Roots in his hand, so he could buff multiple minions if he wanted to go for something like Living Roots and then Power of the Wild buff. But this is not a token version of the Druid, so Power of the Wild not as strong as it would be with the token variant.
Yeah, Innervate, little suspect as well. You know, he's used one Nourish already, which is one of the tools that can potentially allow you to get value out of Innervate in the late game when you spend so much mana on drawing cards. But I agree, it is kind of just the best of a fairly mediocre bunch of cards there from Shtan. So does allow him to just play out the Arcane Giant here as well. And he's going to, of course, hold back the Living Roots. No need to play into things like Swipe right now. And also Living Roots, just such a huge win condition for him when Malagos is in the deck.
Oh, we have a big turn from RDU. He has all the answers in the world for this. He has the mulch for the giant if he wants to do so. He also had a spell power minion in the Azir Drake to survive. So things, there are cards such as Wrath, Living Roots, Swipe. He has all the burn, so he could use those spell powers very effectively. He also has a Fandral and an Innervate to go with it. Well, maybe he doesn't need the Innervate, but he has the Fandral and the Wrath, so that's also something to think about. So Fandral Wrath alone would be deal 5 damage and draw a card.
Is there any way he can get an efficient board clear here and play an Arcane Giant? Anytime you have Giant and Innervate in your hand, you kind of have to look at these things, because Innervate is essentially 3 mana's worth of ramp alongside an Arcane Giant. So assuming he's spending 3 on the mulch straight away, that takes the Arcane Giant down to 8. And at that point, the Innovate would only take him back up to 5. So yeah, it seems unlikely that's going
to
happen.
If he Innovate, that he could only play the Living Roots as another spell to be able to get that out. Really interesting to see where he's going with this. Oh, that's a very conservative line of play. I was expecting maybe to see something a little bit more aggressive, but it's completely fine.
Yeah, I think RDU is just looking at his hand, right, and thinking that he can afford to play relatively slowly here for a turn or two, and then if he needs to clear one more time, his next turn is so much swingier if he's able to develop that Arcane Giant at the same time as well as he gets more mana available to him.
Ooh, so he has the Jungle Moonkin. Getting a really strong clear with it. He knew what he... Standard Dash there, very fast turn. RDU roping in on his previous turn, but Standard Dash just like instantly goes for the Moonkin, gets a 6 damage swipe, and with the Hero Power is able to clean the board. But this is the backswing of the Jungle Moonkin right here.
That is a 4 damage Moonfire if he wants it.
Oh my goodness.
Right
or
there.
Or just 4 damage Wrath and draw a card.
Yep.
So as powerful as the Moonkin was last, and now RDU also reaping the benefits of this Hero Power.
Yeah, and that's exactly what we talked about. Very dangerous card in the mirror, but honestly, it's not terrible for Shtan. He was a long way behind on that board. He used the spell damage to catch him up in tempo for one turn. RDU didn't have an explosive turn. He had a very high value turn, but value is something that Shtan is equipped to deal with right now. He could not deal with how far behind he was on the board.
Yeah. RDU still with the dinner, right? It's been in his hand for such a long time. Another board is turning a little bit against him, but this is looking like such a sweet Fandral turn. Oh, and even that. So Fandral, Wrath, Living Roots, Raven. Oh my.
Yup. I think this is what the kids refer to as going off, Savitz. It's time to just get in there nice and deep.
I don't know, like if Fandral doesn't get too much better than this. Now there's if he finds like a second Innervate or something. Shifters, please.
Second Fandral.
I mean, that's the best pick. I just wanted to see the Shifter, but I mean, he obviously wants to win, so I like the Fandral because of that.
People that like winning don't pick Shifter Zeras.
No.
Confirmed by Savitz. That is a quote I'm taking to the bank.
Yeah, it's a little bit optimistic. Cause you could get the best possible minion next turn from it, but there's also quite a few low-value minions, so it might take the Shifter Zeros 10 turns before you get something useful.
So he can Innovate Moonfire for no reason and play a Arcane Giant here, and that looks like exactly what RDU is doing.
Great
manipulation of the mana this turn from RDU just to make the strongest board possible. Loads up 2 threats. Shtan Adachi again with the snap call on the mulch at the 8-8. Takes care of the Fandral as well. But now the value deficit that RDU's turn against the Moonkin brought him with the double card draw from the Drake and the Wrath. Now that deficit is really starting to pay dividends alongside that huge Fandral turn that he had as well.
Yeah, Standard Dash playing so fast. Like, if RDU is a smart player, I don't really like this because Standard Dash is giving it away that he doesn't have something like a Yawk in his hand by making this play. So I think he should take his time, even if the plays are very obvious. Because if he had a Yawk in his hand, he certainly would have at least considered it. Oh, this is like waving the white flag right here with Moonfire.
I think just from the mental side of the game as well, it might be in RDU's interest to try and break up the pace of this because Shtan is obviously wanting to play very quickly. It's to make himself feel comfortable, maybe a bit of nerves on his side. So RDU as the experienced player could definitely try and slow the pace, but no reason to slow down right now. Just lethal with the double swipe, and RDU comes back from the first game deficit to now take a 2-1 lead.
Yeah, that was quite a convincing one as well. I do think that RDU's draw was maybe slightly better, but he also played it very, very like flawlessly there. And I do like RDU's list also much more than the Jungle Moonkin list. Like, it's kind of fancy, and it's something new, something cool, but I don't think it's that strong.
You're a fancy guy, Savitz. I mean, come on, how can you not favor the fancy list of the two? That seems crazy to me.
I mean, I think there's a reason why Jungle Moonkin has not been played.
That's fair. I definitely have no dispute on that. But I think one of the key turns there potentially was after he chose to go for mana with the Nourish, that first draw being Living Roots and not, you know, like an Azure Drake or even like a Maya Keeper or something, that was such a huge deal that he essentially spent 2 turns doing nothing, right? One turn with the Nourish, and then the following turn afterwards. And
I completely agree. Like having a 6 mana turn where you do nothing, in a mirror match especially, it is so huge. It's such a huge... like tempo loss that right there. That it can make you lose the game.
Yeah. So RDU now comes back from his deficit to a 2-1 lead, and it's worth mentioning as well. We didn't really like touch on this because of how controversial maybe the end of that Rogue game was. But remember the start RDU beat in that Zoo game against the Rogue. The Rogue had both activated SI7 right. agents coming out with the backstab as well, and RDU was able to climb back into that. Now finds himself in a comfortable position in the series because of it. And yep. now we are going to see the Malagos Rogue coming up against Shaman from RDU. Shaman, the class that has been hit harder than any in the recent nerfs, and the class that is still arguably the strongest class in the game.
It's the only class that all 8 players chose to bring. And I was just about to start talking about it, but there is a card in RDU's hand that if I said, let's say a year ago, that we would be seeing this card in competitive events, nobody would have believed me.
You would have been laughed out of the building, Savitz. But yeah, unbelievably, the strategy of taking your totems and making them mighty for zero mana has become a real thing thanks to that other card that RDU has drawn this turn, the Wicked Witch Doctor, which just allows you to flood the board so quickly. Yeah. Leverage cards like Primal Fusion, like Bloodlust, like Flame Tongue Totem. I personally love this deck. I think it's potentially the strongest build of Shaman out there right now.
Really?
No surprise that RDU has brought it to me.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen the deck as well, and I do think that it is quite strong, but I'm not sure if I think it's the strongest version of them all. But it's really impressive to see that that card has evolved from just being a meme.
No, evolve is an entirely different meme. So it's
my bad.
Yeah, this is Totemic Might. No, but Barn's being drawn here. Barn's a very high value card in this deck as well. But quite often you're looking to play it when you have some extra mana available to you, because one of the most powerful things you can get is the Thunderbluff Valiant. But also just things like Flame Tongue Totem, Manatide Totem, Argent Squire. If that's in the list, is something that it's just the card if you pull it out from Barn's. But RDU is not actually running any Squires, so he's got a decision to make here about how he wants to address this board. He can even just choose to go with a Flame Tongue turn to address the Tomb Pillager immediately.
Yeah, I don't know how much I like that. Witch Doctor, he's just going to go for it right here and play the Totemic Might.
His totems are so mighty right now, Savitz.
What does it do? Like, it still dies to the Tomb Pillager.
It does. But it's the only thing he can do to make a push here, really. Basically, he's pulling a lot of his minions outside of range, at least of spot removal from the Rogue hand, which means that the Wicked Witch Doctor and the Manatide Totem were both priority targets on the board. So essentially, he's used his Witch Doctor here to keep his Manatide Totem alive on the board long term.
That is really interesting. And Standard Dashi also prioritizing it so highly to remove that Witch Doctor.
Oh, you have to as Rogue, for sure. Yeah. Like once that board goes wide, you just cannot ever answer it with the Rogue deck. It gets out of range with Totemic Might and Primal Fusion of things like Preparation Fan of Knives with an Azure Drake or something like that. So you essentially just wait to die to Bloodlust at that point if you let them go off with Wicked Witch Doctor.
Makes sense. I have to admit that I'm not all that familiar with this deck, this type of Shaman list just yet. I've played it a bunch of times, but wow, the Manatide is still there. I'm just so used to prioritizing the Manatide so highly. RDU finally getting a hex. He actually didn't get just one hex, but he got two hexes, so he could hex that Tomb Pillager. We talked about it earlier how it can be a very kind of like impactful to Polymorph in the previous match that when Standard Ashi was playing this, that the hexing the Tomb Pillager, taking away that coin is quite huge.
Right. The only downside to it is that it means a very slow turn on RDU's side, only really developing the Totem Golem, which then prevents him from having a Thunderbluff turn on the next turn. But with that thing from below in your hand, you don't mind taking a slow turn or two, because you know you can have an explosive turn at some point with the zero mana thing from below. But that is a huge backstab here, and
He has the
weapon equipped. Okay. So he paused as well, which scared me, as if he realized that he'd just prepped before the backstab. But I forgot he did have the Stormforged Axe equipped.
Oh, this board is looking so strong from Standard Dash right now. And RDU does not have any Lightning Storms in his Shaman deck.
Oop.
He does play 2 Maelstrom Portals, but those are inefficient in clearing the 3 and 4 health minions. Even with spell power, it wouldn't be enough to take those off the board. So I don't really know. RDU is really up against it here. And he almost needs a miracle to come back.
Yeah, RDU has definitely got himself into a bit of a mess here. Hasn't drawn a Maelstrom portal early enough to be able to address this board. No Storm is interesting. It's a build of the deck that I've been messing around with as well. The classic list that people are, you know, currently in top five legend or so with does play one Storm. I took out Storm for an Argent Squire. RDU has took out Storm for a Ragnaros, which is two very different perspectives on what this deck needs. But definitely suffering the loss of the Lightning Storm right now, staring down this board.
Is it Maliga's time? There's also those two Auctioneers, which would be incredible.
That'll do!
Best deals anywhere. Wow. That is so strong, getting those free card draws, because he would have been using the spells anyway to deal with what RDU has on the board. So that Barnes effectively just getting him two cards and providing another like kind of huge threat on the board. Not huge in the sense that it would have great stats, but the ability is very scary.
Yep, and with no Maelstrom Portal in sight for RDU, even if he wanted to deal with the Auctioneer, he'd have to just go ahead and hex it, and that would leave the entirety of Stranodachi's board remaining. So I don't see a way out of this for Radu. I think we might just end up seeing a concede this turn. I forgot about the Ragnaros, though. That is potentially an out for him, but even that looks like it's probably not good enough yeah. in this situation.
That had to be the best one he could hope for. But it's just like, it's so far behind, and it's, even if he gets the best, it like you said, it's just which might be that it's just no good. Ragnaros to file out 1-1, but still dealing 8 damage with the ability. So powerful.
Yep, definitely one of the strongest cards to consider including in your deck if you are playing Barnes. Just so powerful to pull out with that effect, but Stanadachi is going to deal with it pretty comfortably here, and now with Emperor coming down, that is just going to be the game. Inevitable conclusion here. No way RDU can beat both the board and the damage from hand next turn with the discounted burst spells.
Yeah, RDU cannot heal with the deck that he has, and he cannot heal his opponent. It's not possible to deal enough damage. The game is just over, and Stanadachi is going to tie it up.
Yep, Stan goes back to 2-2. The bad news if you're an RDU fan is that he is back on level pegging in this series. The good news if you're a Totemic Might fan is that we get to see some more of that deck.
I certainly want to see more of that. I want to see how it kind of like functions in an environment like this. It has never been played in a tournament before, not at least of this scale. So it is a very cool deck to see, and it's a cool deck to watch. And I personally feel like I might have a thing or two to learn about it and its matchups.
Sure. So if, like me and Savitz, you are a fan of Totemic Might, do not go anywhere. We'll be right back after this. Welcome back, guys. We are currently tied 2-2 in this series, RDU versus Stanodachi. And the decks we have remaining are the Rogue and the Shaman from RDU up against the Druid and the Rhinolock from Stanodachi. And I think the potential story here is two of the most popular classes, two of the most powerful classes, Shaman and Druid. RDU and Stanodachi both have kind of a unique twist on those decks. You know, RDU didn't bring Midrange Shaman, he brought the Totem Shaman, the Wicked Witch Doctor deck, and Stanodachi has gone with that Moonkin build of Druid. So it might come down to which of them can get a win and, you know, prove the worth of their unconventional deck here.
Yeah, the Moonkin in this matchup in particular is pretty much unplayable unless you have lethal with it because of how well the Rogue can use it against you. Pretty cool matchup. I'm still waiting on that Reno Warlock from Stanodachi, but we'll probably see it a little bit later.
Yeah, Savitz, one of the biggest fans of Reno decks I think I've ever seen in my life. I think I've watched you play more hours of Reno Lock on stream than just about any man alive. So Stanodachi, looking at his opening hand here, the powerful Innovate Fandral opening, but nothing really to follow that up. And I think no need to get too ambitious with rushing this out. He'll be wanting to line up that Fandral into a turn where potentially a Tomb Pillager or Azure Drake is looking to be played, so he can follow it up with the Wrath afterwards.
Both hands look a little bit weak, in my opinion, at this stage. RDU does have the Tomb Pillager, and if he picks up an Auctioneer, things are going to suddenly be great. But Stanodachi. Oh, there's the Auctioneer. That is exactly what RDU wanted to see. Now he is kind of like secured to get that off, and he knows that Druid does not have a way to deal with a concealed Auctioneer, so that'll be great once he gets there. And Stunner Dash, turn 2 hero power, turn 3 hero power. If you're the Druid player, that is like the worst feeling.
It's a fantastic feeling as the opponent, though. And RDU gets to be the man to develop the first minion on the board here with the Tomb Pillager. But Stan does have the immediate punish here with the Fandral Innovate Wrath. And I like the way he's played this. You know, I said it was important to get this to line up against a Pillager. If he'd have played his Fandral preemptively with the Innovate or the Coin, it would have just been punished immediately by that Shadow Strike from RDU. And he would essentially have the opportunity, if he wanted to do the exact opposite, even prepping out the Shadow Strike and playing the Tomb Pillager to create the swing exactly the other way around. So Stan being the guy, you know, this is going slow to go fast, essentially, from Stan Adachi. He held back to have a tempo swing later.
I completely agree with you there. He would have been punished so badly by that Shadow Strike if he just played earlier here. Getting a lot of value out of it, and even though Stan Adachi's start is not looking that great, he's not completely out of it just yet. Yogg-Saron, wow.
He is. Yogg, you taunt me. I thought I'd seen the last of you in tournaments that I had to cast, and here he is, taunting me from the right-hand side of Stan Adachi's hand. We'll see whether he has an impact on this game. Of course, if you don't follow the scene too carefully, there's a recent patch which means Yogg-Saron, which was one of the most volatile cards in the game, has been adjusted so that it now stops casting spells if it kills itself or removes itself from play in another way. But RDU is going to cycle through his deck now with the Auctioneer, does have that conceal available to him, and preparations out the wazoo, and that Avis is a huge pickup as well.
Yeah, I mean, I would imagine that he's prepping the Avis here. It's kind of tempting to hold on to try to find like a big Edwin for next turn too. Oh, he's playing the backstep, so I guess he wants to cycle more cards than just going to use the prep fan and his dagger. He's going to take 4 damage doing this, but he does cycle a lot more cards, so I do like it. Another prep. He could make a huge questing and a huge Edwin next turn while drawing like 5 cards.
Yeah,
that's pretty good.
It seems solid indeed. So Stan Adachi, despite having the Yogg available and the mana to be able to get to him fairly quickly, you can see from the Arcane Giant in hand that he's only cast 4 spells now, including that coin that he just cast this turn. So he is potentially a long way off being able to do anything particularly destructive with that Yogg, but you see the other new addition to this deck there, the Curator picking up the 2 minions from his deck, functioning almost like a pre-nerf Ancient of Lore for him, but never mind that. RDU is about to crush some dreams this turn, Savitz.
Yeah, I think there might be some epic sax music going on in RDU's head right now. This is so nuts. He just gets a 3 mana. The Edwin is going to be something like 10-10, and then the questing is also going to be... What's 7-7? I'm trying to like do all the math here.
I mean, if you got that right, you are a genius. Let's find out. If this is 7-7 and 10-10, it's a 6-6 questing.
Yeah.
How big is the Edwin? 0-1 so far, Savitz. And yes, got him. All right.
All right. Well, Stan Adachi is suddenly looking at the Yogg-Saron. How do I play it the fastest? How do I survive the next turn to innervate it out? Yeah. That smile from Stan Adachi is like,
just looking around like, hey, Yogg,
you
can kill yourself, buddy. You'd like one Twisting Nether is all I need. Like, I don't mind.
Drake Living Roots is going to deal with that questing adventure here. So Stan Adachi is going to live to get a... Well, is he? Oh, let me hold that thought. Now I start to look at the...
Slow your roll, Savitz.
Wait a minute.
Is he going to
live? Wait a minute. There's a Leeroy and a Cold Blood, but that is 10 damage.
24?
With the dagger, it's 25. Wow, so RDU would be one off. So he needs to pick up another Cold Blood or an Eviscerate here.
Both preps are used as well, so no way he can like cheat out the Deadly Poison as well for the extra damage. So yeah, he's just going to be a little bit short here, and that means
he could
a window.
He could try to go for it by playing the Leroy and then the Cold Blood and just hope that the Auctioneer draws into Lethal. But if you RDU, I don't think you're too scared of the Innervate Yogg-Saron, especially because of the nerfs right now. So I really like this play. Taking it a little bit slower.
Yeah, completely agree. Picks up the conceal as well, which is huge because Yogg cannot interact with concealed minions too well.
Oh, yeah.
But things like Twisting Nether are still available to him.
Every single like damage spell, such as Shadow Strike, gets directed at the Yogg-Saron instead of the 2 minions from the rogue. So the chances of the Yogg killing itself just went up exponentially.
Yeah, I think you absolutely have to conceal here if you're RDU. You should be able to recognize in RDU's position that the only way you're losing this game is to innovate Yogg-Saron. Absolute nonsense. So conceal gives you the best possible chance, as well as just playing around any spot removal like mulch and swipe. This is a big ask. The old god himself.
But just looking at that arcane giant too, we can count from it how many spells have been casted. If this Yogg-Saron pulls Tanurashi out of this hole, like, it's going to be the most amazing one ever, and it's going to be talked about for a long time.
All right, 7 tries. That's over. That is a one spell Yogg. Boom. The nerf worked, guys. Yogg is dead.
See this smile? I'm happy.
I'm happy to be
real. Obviously, like, we're not laughing at the expense of Stanadachi. Obviously, no. It's a miserable situation for him, but, you know, it's still nice to see Yogg. One spell, Flame Lance to his own face. Beautiful stuff, but the important story is that RDU is now on the hill of making his way through the semi-final. And for RDU, this is a guy, you know, they mentioned it in the pre-show. He has more points than anyone who did not qualify for an actual championship event up until this point. So he has been grinding ladder, grinding tournaments
all year long
for 9 months straight. And this is his one shot at actually finding a route to BlizzCon at this point. So this means a huge amount to him, I'm sure. And he is now one game away from, you know, checking off the first box. You know, quarterfinal down, semifinal down. He's going to be going through it one by one. So he just has to get a win with that slightly controversial pick, the Totem Shaman.
Shaman. I mean, I'm sure he has a pretty good chance to take a win with it. But he's going to be now up against the Reno Lock from Stanudashi. And I have to say, I've been playing a lot of Reno Warlock lately. I've been liking it, especially now that after the card changes, some of the more aggressive strategies got a little bit weaker, and matchups such as Hunter, which was a huge problem for the deck, is less frequent. So Stanudashi banned that Hunter from his opponent, and now he has what I would call a really good matchup for him. So
2 key cards picked up already as well, Hellfire and the Acidic Swamp Ooze. Ooze denying any of that 6 Spirit Claws value and the Hellfire for a potential sweep.
Yeah.
But just with the power of Totemic Might, you can make your totems so mighty.
Ooh, Twilight Drake.
Yes, Twilight Drake picked up. Huge card in every matchup.
That was a great draw. Something Imp Gang Boss would have been great too, but that might even be the best one he could hope for. Did not have a play there for turn 3. You cannot coin out the Mountain Giant. That is a play that some viewers often jokingly suggest when I'm streaming personally, and it does not work that way. After using the coin, the mana cost will go up.
You just don't have the APM for it, Savitz. That's what it is.
Like,
I thought as such a big Reno Lock player, you'd have that APM down to be able to coin Giant, but you've disappointed me. You've let me down.
I'm sorry, Sorrel.
Spirit Claws coming out. That he still got good use out of that Spirit Claws just in the one turn it was equipped, though. Just how insane that card is. 1 mana, 3 damage just for one turn is fine. That is acceptable value. The fact that you get that to stick around for 2 or 3 is, you know, completely ridiculous. So even though RDU got it oozed there, it was able to help him take out the big, big problem of that Twilight Drake. So he won't be feeling too upset about it right now.
Yep. And here, Totemic Might, Primal Fusion. He could just do both, honestly. He has the Bloodlust already in his hand, too. I would really love to see it, because that would keep his totems. Well, not the Searing Totem, but the other 2 totems are going to be safe from Hellfire.
Yep, and I like this. This is the kind of perspective that you need to have with this deck. A lot of people get too greedy with trying to pair Primal Fusion and Totemic Might together with the Witch Doctor specifically, but looking at RDU's hand right now, it's a situation you have to recognize where you have Thunder Bluff in your hand. So the ongoing value of just sticking basic totems to the board is so huge. So using Totemic Might and Primal Fusion to protect that is really, really strong for the next couple of turns.
Yep, here we go. Mountain Giant. But are you so close to lethal? If he just picks up a Lightning Bolt here, he will have it. He has 5 damage on the board. And I think that's exactly lethal. He has 5 damage on the board. Bloodlust provides additional
20.
12.
That is it.
That is 20 damage. That is exactly
yes,
20
yes,
damage.
It is, RDU. Oh, yes,
what?
You've counted correctly. That is turn 6 lethal with Totem Shaman. Savitz, I told you this deck was good. You non-believer!
But I mean, that second Spirit Claw top deck was kind of ridiculous, right?
It really, really was, yeah. RDU picking up exactly the source of damage he needs. It would have been second Lightning Bolt or second Spirit Claw specifically. As RDU bigs up his G2 logo there, proud representative of G2 Esports. And as I said, the man that has been grinding this out all year long, 9 months straight, you know, topping the rankings over and over again consistently every season, you know, and coming here as the points leader in this tournament. He has defeated, honestly, one of my favorite players, a player that I've picked to qualify through a prelim before, Stanardachi. So I'm sad to see him go, but yeah. Hats off to RDU.
Yeah, good showing from Stanardachi as well. I think he played well, but RDU, it's such a just a great example of like hard work paying off. He really prepared hard for with every single deck that he chose to bring all year long, grinding those points that I like we mentioned a little bit earlier. Happy to see him go to the semifinals, and we'll be excited to see how he does against his next opponent.
Yep, well, standing by are two men to talk you through that series in a bit more detail and perhaps revel in the fall of an old god. We'll see. Take it away, TJ and Frodam.
Thanks, guys. It's got to be rigged, Dan. First spell that Yogg-Saron casts in a Hearthstone Championship Tour event kills himself.
Most definitely rigged. I don't think that's a coincidence at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But on the bright side, RDU is going to move on. A 4-2 victory over Stanardachi. I was worried about his decks. A lot of people worried about his decks with the Zoo Warlock not being able to take down the control decks. But he got it done in the end with a turn 6 victory with Shaman against Reno Lock.
Yep. Congratulations, RDU. The year's worth of hard work has not ended. Remember, this is a single elimination best of 7. So if RDU continues to win, just to win 2 more in order to get his spot at BlizzCon, what a story that would be, considering that in 2014, RDU was not even eligible to enter BlizzCon because Romania was not a country that could compete. Since then, the rules have been revisited and revised and ensured that other countries can compete. And RDU said, since then, it's been his number one dream, just to get on that big stage, follow his teammate Tyson's footsteps, getting to the semifinals last year. Can he be the one who puts G2 as a world champion team?
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see if he's going to be able to stand up against some of the other decks in the tournament. Mm-hmm. I can see there, though, a clip from one of the games here, game number 2, I think, where Stan actually decided to eviscerate a Civil War Golem instead of eviscerate or hold on to the eviscerate to save it for face for Malygos next turn. We're actually doing the odds and calculating the odds backstage, and we came up with a 60% chance to win if he had held on to it going in the next turn. Is that correct?
Yeah, there's a lot of moments in this match where it felt like one player had an opportunity to try and just put their opponent in a position where they'd be in a favorable spot to win. You looked at Stanardachi's moment where he had the Malygos coin, Eviscerate, and the Preparation with Sinister Strike. That's a combination of cards that RDU probably just won't play around because it's just unlikely that he has it, even if he does, and he can't afford to do it. And then you have to peg on what's the chances that your opponent can kill you on. It doesn't really matter what you draw as the rogue. It's what the Zoo Warlock player can do from that point. And we pegged them on Soulfire and one other card. So we only had 2 outs, or I guess the third card could have been the out already. So 3 out of the 14, 2 out of the 13, and so forth. Really unlikely scenario, and like we just pointed out, around 60%+ chance to be able to win from that point on. Didn't end up getting it, and who knows? Maybe that could have been the series deciding moment. Now, RDU did win 4-2, so a lot of things could have been just left up in the air in terms of question marks, but you have to wonder what could have been. And when it's best of 7, single elimination, TJ, I want to take some of those odds because you have to do it in order to beat some of the players of this caliber.
Yeah, RDU is a player who decided to target, you know, knowing his first round opponent, Stanardachi. It's going to be interesting to see whether or not his decks can stand up against the other ones in the format. But we're ready for quarterfinal match number 2. So let's send it back over the desk